Jean and I had the flag store in Downingtown for 22 years, and as a result of having the store, a lot of people had asked us if we would do a program on the flag, and we did. Pretty much started right after 9/11 and kind of blossomed from there. So I've assembled a series of flags here. These first three are British, and the remainder are U.S. flags, some from the various time frames, whether it be the Revolution or what have you, coming up through today. But just wonder, how many veterans do we have here today? You say thank you for your service, and the Vietnam vets are, so welcome home. You probably all heard all the redneck jokes, right? Well, our definition of a redneck is, you're redneck if it had never occurred to you to be offended by the phrase one nation under God. You never protested seeing the Ten Commandments in a public place. You still say Christmas instead of winter festival. You remove your hat and bow your head when someone prays. You stand and place your hand over your heart when they play the national anthem. You treat Vietnam vets with great respect and always have. You've never burned an American flag when we kicked someone's butt that did. You know what you believe and you aren't afraid to say it no matter who's listening. You respect your elders and expect your kids to do the same, and you give your last dollar to a friend. So this is kind of what this is about here. It's about patriotism, it's about the evolution, what have you. We're looking at 522 years in this time frame. And other than this yellow flag in the center, they're all kind of a combination of red, white, blue, or a combination thereof. And looking at these was something that Ronald Reagan said way back when. He said, freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We did not pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, and handed on to them so that they will do the same, or one day we will spend our sunset years telling our children what it was once like when the United States, when men were free. So a lot has happened in this time frame to bring us to where we are today. I'm going to start out with a flag here. It's called St. George's Cross. It's a white flag, red cross. It came here in 1497 with John Cabot. It's a British flag. When the Mayflower came, what they did was they took St. George's Cross and they superimposed St. Andrew's Cross on top of it. This would be called the King's Colors. It came here in 1620. You pretty much look at it as being the flag of Great Britain or the Union Jack. And then Queen Anne designed a flag called the I just had a senior. This man back here thinks I'm 83 years old. This is the British Red Ensign. The British Red Ensign came here during the colonization, and basically this is a combination of St. George's Cross, St. Andrew's Cross, the King's Colors up in the upper left-hand corner. So during the colonization, this is the flag that that you'd be flying. People say, what flag do I fly in front of my house? If it's prior to the Revolution, you would be flying this flag, which is actually a British flag, and most people choose not to do that. The people of Taunton, Massachusetts said, you know what, we're going to deface that flag. We're going to put the words Liberty and Union on there. So basically, it's the British Red Ensign with the words Liberty and Union, and the folks of Taunton, Massachusetts defaced that by placing the words on that flag. Listen, my children, you shall hear the midnight ride of Paul Revere on the 18th of April of 75. This is the Continental flag. So this flag was the flag that would have been carried by the folks during that time frame. The flag was carried up to Concord. It was the 18th of April, so the 19th of April would have been the first shot, the shot that was heard around the world. And basically what they did was they took the British Red Ensign and they replaced it with a pine tree. The pine tree was a really significant subject for the Western Massachusetts area, being a very rural area, what have you. Following the shots at Concord, a very major battle was the Battle of Bunker Hill. Actually, the Bunker Hill battle was not actually fought specifically on Bunker Hill. The folks here in the New World, they decided they were going to fortify both Breed's Hill and Bunker Hill. So now we have a flag that did not fly during Bunker Hill, but the fact that there were three advances by the British, and they were repelled two of the times. The third time, the Americans had to retreat because they ran out of ammunition. So they did not defeat the British at Bunker Hill, but they had a substantial presence, and it was thought to be a very moral victory. So that this flag was designed, it's called the Bunker Hill flag, and it's designed to commemorate that. It's a combination, again, of the British red ensign, but instead of red, it went to blue. It's got the St. George's Cross in the upper left, and the pine tree is also added in there. We advance to the first ones that have the stripes. Okay, 13 red and white stripes. And again, I got St. George's Cross, I got St. Andrew's Cross, I've got the colors in the upper left. And this was called the Cambridge flag. Pretty much Washington was the one that was really the subject that had designed this and was the person behind that particular flag. We get to the first of the military flags. Again, I got 13 red and white stripes. I've got an elongated snake. It's called the First Navy Jack, and it says the words, "Don't tread on me." Okay, so you look at why the rattlesnake. The rattlesnake is known only to this continent. It does not have any eyelids. It has an emulsion that will cleanse the eye from any foreign objects. So it's thought to always be awake, always vigilant. It's not an active aggressor. It will respond in deadly force and never retreats. So the rattlesnake is one that was considered as part of that military presence, if you will, showing the strength of the military. Following 9/11, if you had a pickup truck other than a U.S. flag, this was your flag. A lot of people call this the Don't Tread on Me flag, what have you. This is the Gadsden flag. It was designed by Colonel Gadsden, South Carolina. It's got a coiled rattlesnake, and again, the Don't Tread on Me insignia on the bottom. Not too many people know that there's another rattlesnake flag, the Don't Tread on Me. This is the Culpeper. This is the Culpeper Minutemen. Liberty or death, don't tread on me. Again, the coiled rattlesnake. So these are basically the local, if you will, flags of the Revolution. We get into the area here that you're kind of familiar with a lot of these. You've seen them, you've flown them, and you know, they're kind of the historic flags, if you will. You probably call this the Betsy Ross flag. We call it the First Stars and Stripes. First Flag Act said one star for every state, one stripe for every state. Did not give the configuration for the stars, and did not give you how many points were supposed to be on the stars. So this turned out to be 13 red and white stripes, 13 stars, 5-pointed stars in a circuit pattern. This flew for the first time in battle on 9/11. It was September 11th of 1777. We had General Howe that sailed south from the New York Harbor to the head of the Elk River. He disembarked. It took him 6 weeks to get there, 157 ships, 18,000 men, 500 horses. They disembarked and they marched north. We had General Washington was defending the capital city at the time. He was stationed at the ford of the stream. Washington was doing okay until Howe sent a detachment behind the lines and Washington got caught in a crossfire. That day, Washington lost 1,200 men, killed, captured, wounded. We had Howe lost 600 men, killed, captured, wounded. It was the largest battle of the Revolution, and it's only down the street from us and down in Chad's Ford. The ford was Chad's Ford. The capital city was Philadelphia. If you ever have the opportunity to take some folks on a little bit of a historic trip, if you will, kids, grandkids, nieces, nephews, whatever, this is the battlefield at Brandywine is a great location to go there and kind of walk around. It's real quiet, what have you. And incredibly, there are only 8,000 visitors per year that actually go to that battlefield. And it is the largest, if you will, of the Revolution. And again, it's in our own backyard. So we pass through the Revolution itself. Okay, and we get to the next stage on this thing as we're coming along. We're working our way through from 1777 on through. And we now have, again, 13 stripes, red and white stripes. I've got the only flag that starts with white and ends with white as far as the stripes. It's got the number 76 in the upper left. It's got 13 stars. It has 11 in a crescent, and it's got two rogue stars. Ironically, these are 7-pointed stars. Again, the First Flag Act didn't say how many points are the stars. This is called the Bennington flag. It flew at Fort Bennington in Vermont. Fort Bennington was a very significant warehouse, if you will, of munitions, ammunition, firepower, what have you. And the colonists were successful in defeating the British at Fort Bennington. Had they not defeated them at Fort Bennington, probably would not have been successful at Saratoga. So this is a very significant flag, if you will, for that particular era. Yes, sir?
Why did they start that point in the red?
There was nothing in the Flag Act that said any of the sequence. Again, it was one stripe for each state. They just, for whoever designed this, they designed it with the first one being the white. It's the only one that that shows white, both first and last. Here's another one. It's red, white, and blue stripes, 13. 13 stars, they're eight-pointed stars. This is called the Serapis flag, or it could be called the Franklin flag, was designed by Benjamin Franklin. The Bonhomme Richard, actually there was not very much happening as far as naval warfare in the Revolution, but the Bonhomme Richard would have been the flagship of the Revolution, and it defeated the Serapis. Okay, unfortunately, as the men from John Paul Jones said, don't give up the ship, that was from that battle. And when the Serapis had been defeated by the Bonhomme Richard, they were boarded by all the colonists. However, the Bonhomme Richard sank. Okay, so that even though the Bonhomme Richard sank, the colonists did take possession of the Serapis. This flag then flew on the Serapis to the Dutch harbor of Texel, and it's pretty much known as the Serapis flag as a result of that. So passing through the Revolution, we move to, now we defeated England, but they said, hey, we're not done with you, so we're gonna come back and try and hit you again. So this flag flew during the War of 1812. The War of 1812 was thought to be a year-long war, so they said, well, we'll call it the Year of 1812. Turned out to be a three-year war. First Flag Act, one stripe for every state. I got 15 stripes on this. It's the only flag that has more than 13. It's got 15 stripes, 15 stars. This flag was made by a flag maker by the name of Mary Pickersgill. It flew at the harbor in Baltimore at Fort McHenry. Fort McHenry had 1,000 men. They were all stationed there. And there was a young lawyer that was going out to a British warship that was in the harbor trying to release a doctor friend of his. And during the night, the British decided they were going to attack Fort McHenry. So the battle lasted all night. The next day, they look out, the young lawyer and his doctor friend look out, and they saw the flag flying, and the lawyer wrote a poem, and it turned out the lawyer was Francis Scott Key. The poem became the national anthem. Okay, this would be called the Star-Spangled Banner. Okay, the original to this flag, as I say, was made by Mary Pickersgill. It was damaged pretty significantly, but recently it was totally restored, not to the pristine condition as when it was made, but to the point where it would not be deteriorating more anymore. And here you can find this flag. It's in the Smithsonian right now. Multi-million dollar project to get this thing restored. There was no federal funds for this. It was the Pew Foundation and Ralph Lauren from Polo had funded that entire thing. Okay, the officer in charge on that particular day was George Armistead. George Armistead was from a very popular and very famous Virginia family, and the flag was given to him. So that this flag was given to him, he ultimately then gave it back to the government, to the Smithsonian. And he was very highly regarded as a real hero, because of 1,000 men, not one man left his station, and as a result, they were able to prevail and defeat the British and negate that assault. So we look forward now, we're at War of 1812. That's when they came back and Dolly Madison had to escape in the carriage, and they burned the White House and what have you. But again, we defeated the British at that war. So we move forward to the Civil War. With the War of 1812, we realized that the coastline was pretty vulnerable to attack. And we look at Charleston, South Carolina. There was a fort there called Fort Moultrie. And Fort Moultrie was on the edge of the harbor. The harbor was about a mile wide. The guns could shoot about a mile, so they think, you know what, this is a problem. We better fortify Fort Moultrie with another fort somewhere in the harbor so we can protect the city of Charleston. But there was no place to put it. So for 11 years, they dragged granite out of New Hampshire, and they built this giant island called Fort Sumter. Okay, and they built the fort on this island. Well, now we get to the 12th of April of 1861. We had Robert Anderson had 85 men, and he was at Fort Moultrie, or he was at Fort Sumter, and the South Carolinians were at Fort Moultrie. Okay, the South Carolinians were the first ones to secede from the Union. They seceded a year before anybody else. So here we are. There's a Union ship coming down to resupply Anderson at Fort Sumter, and the South Carolinians said, you know, we can't have this, so we better do something, and we're going to fire on him. So we have the Fort Moultrie flag flying, and now the South Carolinians fire onto the U.S. forces, or to the colonial force, or the U.S. forces, if you will, the northern forces of the Civil War. That was the first shot. It was April 12th of 61. So we have April 12th, 13th, and 14th. There are 3 days. Okay, at the end of the third day, nothing happened. There was nobody, no injuries. I mean, it was like a mile-long shoot, and nothing happened. Nobody was hurt. The ship came down from the north. We had Anderson that said, you know what, let's just get on here, and we're going to go north. And he said, let's just volley all these cannons. So he volleys all the cannons, and in the middle of the sequence of volley, he had one misfire, and he had a man lost. So he had one casualty at Fort Sumter, and it was friendly fire, if you will, from a misfire of his own cannon. So they now go north, and so the first shot was the 12th of April of 61. So now we move into that summer, and we have something that's going to come about as the Battle of Bull Run. Okay, if you're from the north, the battles of the Civil War are known by the closest body of water. If you're from the south, it's the closest town. So the Battle of Bull Run and the Battle of Manassas are the same battle. The people in the Potomac region said, hey, you know what, we have the Army of Northern Virginia coming up. We're going to take the Army of the Potomac. We're going to go to this little picnic. We're going to watch this little skirmish, and it's going to be really cool. So they had all these people that were all dressed up, and they had their carriages and their picnics and whatever, and they go down to this farm in Bull Run, village of Manassas. And Wilmer McLean had owned this farm, and Wilmer McLean, you know, his front lawn basically became the Battle of Bull Run. So as we know what happens there, it was a day-long battle. All the picnic baskets got thrown out the back, and the people are scurrying all the way back to the Potomac. And we now have the official start, if you will, of the Civil War on that battlefield. So we move forward through all of this, and we look at, you know, what's been happening. I mean, there's a whole lot going on. So we move into Gettysburg. That was July 1st, 2nd, 3rd of 63. So we're basically 2 years into this, because it was July of 61. Now we're July of 63. 2 years, we got the Army of Northern Virginia coming in to the area of Gettysburg. We got the Army of the Potomac, and they meet in the village of Gettysburg. So it was the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd. If you look at the battle on the first day of Gettysburg, basically the Confederates moved the Northern Army out of Gettysburg. On the second day, the Northern Army moved the Southern Army out of Gettysburg. So the beginning of the first day and the ending of the second day were kind of the same position. The third day was the key to this whole thing. So we have, now we had all of the Army of the North were all up on the top of the ridge. Okay, they're behind a stone wall. It's a mile to the woodland, and Lee had all of his men down in the woods. We had, in the center was the Emmitsburg Road. There was a five-rail split-rail fence that was across that road. And Lee thought that he was invincible. So he's saying, hey, we can do this. He sends out his long-range cannon, and they fire. And basically, he was assuming that all of the reinforcements that Meade had were well behind that stone wall. So he was overshooting that stone wall. Well, what he didn't know was that Meade had most of his reinforcements close to the front line. So we had this extended firepower. All of a sudden, they run out of ammunition, and they say, well, we're going to go back and resupply. And Lee says, no, we're going to advance. So it was about 3 o'clock on the afternoon of the 3rd of July, and you notice Pickett's chart. There were three divisions that started out. Pickett was in the middle. This was the first time, George Pickett, the first time that he had actually led his men in battle. They never even took time to remove the rails the night before from the split rail fence. So now they're coming up this mile-long run, and you have the high ground. Lee just thought that he was invincible, and he said, I don't really care that we don't have the good ground, we don't have the high ground, we can take this anyway. And they came up, and it was a relatively short time, and it was just a decimation of the Army of Northern Virginia. One of the men that made it up, too, was a brigadier general, and it was Lewis Armistead. Ironically, here you got Lewis Armistead, the nephew of George Armistead. George Armistead was the hero who held the position at Fort McHenry, trying to save the Union, and now all of a sudden we got Lewis Armistead, his nephew, he's trying to destroy this and to separate from the Union. It was an incredible battle. There were a lot of newsmen that came after the fact, and they were saying that they thought that all the men from the Northern Army were angry with each other because they're shouting and they're yelling at each other. Well, the problem is that they were deaf from all of the cannon fire that went on during that whole time frame. Lincoln was just angered beyond belief at Meade, because Meade, after this, here's his army is basically devastated. He did not pursue the retreating Army of Northern Virginia. The wagon train of injured and wounded was 17 miles long. The war should have ended in 30 days. So here we go from the 3rd of January, and we fast forward now to the 9th of April of 63. So it was another 2 years. So rather than 90 days, it basically was a two-year time frame until it was a Palm Sunday. It was in Appomattox Courthouse. It was the 9th of April that Lee surrendered to Grant. Ironically, this was in the house of an individual who lived in Appomattox Courthouse by the name of Wilmer McLean. So here, Wilmer McLean, way back when, owned the farm at Manassas, so the Civil War started in his front lawn, and it ended in his front living room 4 years later. So we have Lee surrenders to Grant on the 9th of April. That's Sunday. It was Palm Sunday. And now we move to Good Friday, and Robert Anderson says to Lincoln, hey, come with me. I'm going to go down to Fort Sumter, and it's exactly 4 years to the day, the 14th of April, that I lowered the flag. I'm going to raise the flag again to show that the Civil War is over. And Lincoln said, no, I'm going to go to the theater. So he ends up going to Ford's Theater on the 14th, and he's shot, dies the next day in the hotel on the 15th of April. So the irony again of here, this time frame of how all that moved. You look at the number of casualties and number killed in the Civil War, it's mind-boggling. There were 614,000 killed. If you add in the wounded, you're looking at 917,000. If you equate that total number to the population at the time to today, today's number would be 9.2 million. The devastation was incredible, and a lot of it had to do with the advancement of the firepower. When we look at the Revolutionary War, we were using musket balls, and a musket ball was a round ball. It pretty much would pierce you, and it would go through your body, and you'd be wounded. But they had something called a mini ball for the Civil War. It was kind of like an extended root beer barrel. And when it hit your arm, it wouldn't pierce your arm, it would tear your arm off your body. So that the munitions had advanced, but the technique and the strategy didn't. They just lined up in front of each other and shot the hell out of each other. Just incredible that you know, we never really advanced beyond that, and the death was just incredible. The trick question is, how many were Americans? And they were all Americans. It shouldn't have even been. It wasn't even a civil war. It shouldn't have been called a civil war. It should have been called the War of Secession. A civil war is when a power wants to take over the government. They didn't want to take over. They just wanted to leave. So it really should have been a War of Secession. So we get through that one. We continue to advance. We now go through. We fast forward all the way up to World War I. We just went through 11-11-11, the 11th hour, the 11th day of the 11th month, which was Veterans Day. It used to be known as Armistice Day. That particular day was the day that that World War I had ended, World War I. So we look at World War I, the war to end all wars, and all of a sudden we get into World War II. Okay, the dates that we're in, like all throughout the year, you know, we should be remembering some of these things. I mean, we're looking now, we're close to December 7th. December 7th of 41 was when the Japanese did the attack on Pearl Harbor. Okay, even as devastating as it was, when Nimitz went to check this out, he responded back to the president and said, you know, we were very, very fortunate at Pearl Harbor. Number one, they attacked on a Sunday. And Sunday, the ships were in harbor. Sunday, most of the men were on shore leave. So there were fewer casualties than had they attacked when we were at sea. Second thing is, they attacked when we were in the harbor. We're in shallow water. The ships sank, but we were able to bring them up again. Had we had them at sea, they'd have been at the bottom of the ocean, we probably never would have been able to recover some of them. Next thing is, they did not take out the dry docks. So we were able to now raise the ships and put them in the dry docks at Pearl Harbor. Had they taken out the dry docks, we would have had to haul them to the coast, to California. So we lucked out there. But the big thing was, the thing that devastated, we'd have lost the war completely. They did not take out the oil reserves. They were supposed to do a second pass, and they never did. The first pass, they couldn't take out the oil reserves because the sky would have been black with smoke. They wouldn't have been able to see what they were doing. But had they taken out the oil reserves, that would have devastated us completely, because that was the whole thing runs on fuel. Okay, so we now look at, we got September 7th of 41. Okay, we can now fast forward to June the 6th of 44. Okay, we're looking at a time frame here. I mean, we got the front against Germany, the European theater. We got the front against Japan in the Pacific. So our first advance is going to be, okay, we're going to now land, we're going to take possession of control of the European theater, and we're going to land on Normandy. Had Dan Rather been on the beach at Normandy, the war would have been over in 2 weeks. We'd everybody be home. We'd be seeking German doing the goose step right now. Because when you look at that, we had a lot of customers that came in the store that were part of that Operation Overlord. A number of them were actually on the beaches of Normandy, and the question was, how do you get across the beach? And their answer was, we don't know how anybody got across the beach. It was devastating. So we have now the landing at Normandy on June the 6th of 44. We're now trying to get to Berlin. So we go from June the 6th of 44 until May the 8th of 45, when we actually got to May the 8th is VE Day, Victory in Europe. Okay, so we're fighting our way through. We had the Battle of the Bulge. The Battle of the Bulge was the last confrontation that we had, whereby Germany, that was their big hurrah. And it's called the Battle of the Bulge because the line of the front line had a big bulge in it, and the reference came to that. We basically knew that we were going to win World War II prior to that because we had taken out Hitler's ability to resupply his oil. We'd taken out his oil reserves. So, I mean, that was known only because you had the panzer tanks were running out of fuel on the battlefield. So we knew in advance that we were making headway there. So we now go forward. We're looking at Hitler married Eva Braun on the 29th of April. They committed suicide on the 30th of April, and then Germany fell on the 8th of May. We know that as VE Day, Victory in Europe. So okay, so we're set. We got European theaters taken care of. We're good. So now we've got to consider, what are we doing in the Pacific? D-Day was the day known for the invasion of Normandy. X-Day was the name that was given to the invasion of Japan. Okay, X-Day was scheduled for September or for November of 45. Fortunately, Truman decided that we're going to drop the bomb on the Hiroshima. Well, we did Hiroshima, and then we did Nagasaki. We did the 6th of April, or the 6th of August. We did the 9th of August, and the Japanese surrendered on the 14th. It was actually the 15th because it was the international dateline. So the 15th of August, it was the 14th, 15th, depending on where you were, Japan or here. So the 15th of August, they had surrendered. The official signing of the documents on the the deck of the Missouri in Tokyo Harbor. That was actually on the 2nd of September, and we know that as VJ Day, Victory in Japan. Okay, if you're in Australia or in Europe, they know it as VP Day, Victory in the Pacific. So you look and say, you know, did we really, was this the right thing to do, dropping the bomb on Hiroshima and on Nagasaki? We suited up 16 million for that war. We lost 413,000. The word came down from the Emperor of Japan that said the first U.S. or Allied boot to hit our shore, the first thing we do, we kill all the POWs. So that would have been like another 300 plus thousand that would have been killed there. And the estimate was that would have been a million additional U.S. and Allied that would have been killed in the invasion, because the Emperor said, you know, pitchforks, whatever, you fight to the death, so that they're looking at possibly as many as 5 to 7 million Japanese would have been killed. We're looking at like 126,000 in each of the two cities. We're less than a quarter of a million Japanese that were killed during the two bombings, but it could have been upwards of 7 million. I always look at that as being World War II was the last war that we really fought to win. You look at the two fronts; it was 4 years. Okay, we did 4 years. We're set. You know, the rules of engagement were you killed the enemy. So from World War II, we move on to Korea, which was just, it wasn't even a war, it was a police action. And the police action said, okay, there are certain rules of engagement, whatever, and we never really finished that. I mean, it was only recently that we're now finalizing some of the paperwork on the ending of that confrontation. And then we move on to Vietnam, and Vietnam really was not fought on the battlefield as much as it was fought on our TV screens. It's incredible that Walter Cronkite, if you had to pick a person that would have been responsible for the final results of the Vietnam War, it would be Walter Cronkite. And the reason is we had the Tet Offensive. The Tet Offensive was launched by the North Vietnamese, and even though we fought the Tet Offensive and beat them and we won that offensive, it was not won by the margin that was anticipated in the overall scope of things. And Walter Cronkite came on the TV and said, we lost the Tet Offensive. And when the president heard that, he said, Johnson said, hey, so goes Walter Cronkite, so goes the American people. And that's when everything, the wheels fell off completely. I mean, we had everything we wanted. We went to the peace table. We had everything that we wanted on that. There's a book that's written. It's called American Amnesia. It's a pretty good book to read, only because we had everything we wanted. We left Vietnam. We promised the South Vietnamese, the Arvin Army, we promised that we were going to give them peace for peace. P-I-E-C-E for P-I-E-C-E. You lose a tank, we give you a tank. You lose a gun, we give you a gun. You lose a jeep, we give you a jeep. And it was Teddy Kennedy and John Curry are the two that they just lobbied against that, and we never ever fulfilled that obligation. So we basically walked away. The Viet Cong Army came down and just devastated the South. We left them high and dry, didn't give them the support that we promised. Saigon became Ho Chi Minh City, and everything just went from there. So I look at that as being one of the major things, where you fight a war, let the generals do it on the ground, and don't let the people in Washington fight the war for you. Because so now look at where we are now. We're 18 years fighting people that live in caves. You know, you got the rules of engagement of what you're allowed to do, what you're not allowed to do. It's just incredible how all of that happened. So we're moving forward from that, and we come up to the flag that we have today. Okay, today's flag, we have 13 stripes. Second Flag Act said one stripe for each of the first 13 colonies. So that 15-star, 15-stripe flag today would look like a corduroy suit if we had that with one stripe for every state. So we have 13 stripes. They start with red, they end with red. We have a star for each of the states, and the star is now a five-pointed star. Okay, so when you look at the flag, it's like, what does it mean to all the different people that are involved? You know, you've got the military is going to look at it one way, you're going to look at it, a civilian will look at it a different way, what have you. it's pretty much lost the respect in many ways, and not necessarily out of intent, but just out of ignorance, that people don't know what do you do and how do you treat the flag and how is it done. So I kind of want to transform into what do you do with today's flag and how do you really look at it. Okay, behind me you got two flags. You got the U.S. flag and you got the Pennsylvania flag. U.S. flag is always on the left. Okay, so when you look at it, the U.S. flag is always on the left. The left is really important. Okay, when you wear a flag pin, you always wear it on your left side. You always wear your flag pin over your heart. Okay? When you display a flag, this is the only thing you can do. That flag has treatment that the only additional treatment that you can make is with that. The eagle should be facing forward, which it isn't, but that's okay. We'll let them go. At least they have it on the left. Okay, there are only two things that you can do to the flag. One is you can put the gold trim on the fringe, and the other one you can have two gold tassels hanging down. That's the only thing you can do to that flag. When you see a Native American that's superimposed over it, or a Harley Davidson motorcyclist, that's a desecration of the flag. We had a guy come in the store years ago. He wanted to have the twin towers over. I won't do it. He got all upset. I'm like, no, it's a desecration. That's not going to happen. And you don't realize that the only thing you can do is allow it to appear as it is and only to hang freely. You would never use it as a tablecloth. You would never use it to festoon a ceiling. Jim Craig, who was the goalie in the 1960 Olympics when the United States Olympics team beat the Russians, and at the end of the game he took the flag and he wore it like a shawl. He didn't really mean to, but that was really a desecration of the flag. It's not meant to be worn as a shawl or as a piece of clothing. Now, if you have a flag that you've knitted onto a shirt, if you have a flag that's been printed onto a blouse or whatever, that's never been a flag. That's the image of a flag, but it's never been a flag. So what do you do with your flag once you've retired it? How do you retire it? A flag is retired either when it's tattered, when it's faded, and when it's past its useful life. Okay, they're burned in a special ceremony. The Marine Corps League in Downingtown will collect them. Brandywine Flags in Marchwood will collect them. You have any American Legion, any VFW. There are many places that you can do that. People will come in the store and they buy a flag and say, I got an old flag, what do I do with it? And say, well, bring it in and we'll retire it. And they come in and they have like eight of them. They go like, well, we had these in our closet. We didn't know what to do with them. It's kind of funny. So you retire the flag. Now, one of the things that people don't realize is that flags come in certain sizes. Okay, there's a 3x5, there's a 4x6, there's a 5x8, there's a 6x10. There's a 5x9.5. A 5x9.5 is an odd flag. It's a coffin flag. Okay, so the coffin or the casket flag is one that is a little bit longer than normal to cover the length of the coffin. When you see it, it's draped on a coffin, and the field is over the heart of the deceased. Okay, number one rule, the only time you can drape a flag on a coffin is for a veteran. Gene's dad was in the Merchant Marines. Merchant Marines, he was hauling troops back and forth across the ocean during World War II. And when he passed away, he had a coffin flag that Merchant Marines, being in the military engagement, what have you, he qualified for that. And the mortician was a veteran, and he was also assigned to Dover, and he would be helping to prepare the bodies and what have you for burial when you're returning from the theater of engagement. And he went crazy over a situation. They're from Maryland. Her dad's from Chestertown. And here there was a woman, it could be anybody. It was a firefighter, okay? There was this firefighter that had passed. They had the firefighter in a casket on the fire truck, and they draped it in a flag, which was totally wrong, because this firefighter was not a veteran. The other thing is you never placed anything on top of the flag. They piled all kinds of flowers on top of the flag, so it was a second desecration. And again, they thought that this was something that was honoring the individual, and they didn't do it on purpose, but it just, that's the way it all shook out. The Memorial Day Parade, we had for years given out little stick flags this size to 1,000, 2,000 flags on Memorial Day. You come to the Memorial Day Parade in Downingtown, and you come and you don't have a flag, we give you a flag so that when you have the colors passing through, the veterans coming through, you're able to at least show your flag. There's a woman. There's a person sitting on this on the curb drinking a Wawa coffee, and I handed her a flag. And the first thing she did, she put it down and used it as a coaster to put her coffee on. So I explained to her that this is not the proper use of a flag. And now there's this group of about 50 explaining, listening to my explanation, and she probably won't do that again. And again, it wasn't out of desecration or out of you know, any malice. It was just not thinking. The other thing, when the colors pass, you stand. Okay, you stand. So as you have the flag coming by, you stand, you place your hand over your heart. If you're a man, you take your hat off. Don't put your hat over your heart. Put your hat over your shoulders so your hand is over your heart. Okay? And you show the respect that is due with that. You know, that's normal protocol. But people, again, don't understand that. Going back to the retirement side of it, one thing, a coffin flag. Once you're at the cemetery, the flag is removed from the coffin, and there are 13 folds to get it to look like a cocked hat of Washington's army. Okay, that flag has been retired. That's it. So even though it's not tattered, it's not torn, it's not been defaced in any way, it has served its useful purpose. Its only purpose is to cover the coffin. You should never unfold that. Okay? If you ever see a flag flying and you look at it, something wrong with that flag. It's this long, skinny flag. It's somebody is flying a coffin flag from a veteran that perhaps from their family. They think it's really cool. It's like, well, we're going to honor my great uncle by flying his coffin flag. It should never, ever be unfolded. How do you display your flag? Okay, we ride, we're in a motorcycle group called the Warrior Watch Riders. We escort troops back from the theater of engagement or to the cemetery for interment. And it's really a neat thing because they close down the highways you never stop. When you get on, you're escorting the troops, what have you, and you go through every red light. There are police that are holding off the traffic on all the on-ramps and whatever. And every overpass has flags on it. There are people there. There are hundreds of people on the sides, what have you. And you find a lot of the firefighters have their crossed ladder arch, and now they display the flag hanging vertically. Okay, when you hang a flag vertically, the field is always on the left as you look at it like this. Okay, anybody see the movie Hoosiers? Every flag in every field house is backwards. Okay, you see the movie Run Up to D-Day when Tom Selleck was playing Eisenhower and he was in Montgomery's headquarters and they were panning there and they were explaining to the King and Queen of England how they're going to have the five beaches at Normandy, whatever, the flag was backwards. Remember the Titans, the football coach, the flag in his field, his office is backwards. It kind of wrecks the movie for me. So it's funny. There's also something called the honor flight. Honor flight is, it was started a number of years ago, and it was basically a 747 that had passengers. Half of them were veterans, half of them were escorts. Every passenger that was a veteran had an escort. And they would fly them from all points of the country, and they'd fly them down to Washington, D.C. And they would tour the Vietnam Memorial, the World War II Memorial, the Korean Memorial. They would do Arlington Cemetery, and they'd also do the Air Force Memorial, okay? Here in Philadelphia, this area, it's so close, they bus them. So they're like 6-7 buses, and then we would end up meeting them at the Delaware line on 95 and escort them up to a place in Springfield. So this was like on a Saturday with the honor flight, and we had escorted, you know, like 500 of us that were escorting these buses, and it was really cool. So on Monday, I had to do a repair of a flagpole at Chichester School District. So I'm there, and I get my stuff out of the truck, and I get my equipment out, whatever, and here comes this young guy, and he's wearing his firefighter T-shirt, and I go, oh, you're with the fire company. He says, have you ever heard of the honor flight? And I'm like, yeah. And he said, yeah, we were doing the thing. I said, where were you? He said, I was on the second bridge. I said, your flag was backwards. So I then pulled up my phone because she was on the back and she's taking videos. And I'm like, here it is. So now he takes it back. And again, they didn't mean to, but they just hang it the wrong way, you know? So again, the flag, you know, you're doing it on the left. Okay, half staff. Okay, people say half mast. Mast is on a ship, it's half staff. So when do you fly a flag at half staff, and how do you do that? Okay, half staff is where you go out in the morning and you raise your flag to full staff, and then you bring it down about a third. So that a lot of people bring the hem of the flag to the center of the pole, and then the whole flag is like almost dragging on the ground. So you bring it down about a third so that the body of the flag is pretty much in the center. Okay, so you bring it down to a third to fly it at half staff. Then at night, you would then raise it to full staff and then lower it, fold it, retire it for the evening. Okay, there's one time that is different, and that's Memorial Day. Memorial Day, you take it to full staff, you bring it down a third, and then at 12 noon is when it goes to full staff. So 11:59 and 45 seconds, you start to raise it. Because as you remember, as the colors would come in to the ceremony, they would have the 21-gun salute, they would play taps, they would do the national anthem, and then you would raise your flag to full staff, and you fly to full staff. Okay, so if you have a vertical flagpole at your house, you do the half staff. What happens if you have an angled pole like this off of your front porch? How do you do half staff? You know, it's a 5-foot pole, so you bring it down like 18 inches. Well, to signify that, you take a large black bow and hang it off the end. So a large black bow on the end of your short flagpole. And you can get those. They sell those down at the Brandywine Flags as well. But any kind of a big black bow would signify half staff or mourning with that. How long do you fly it at half staff? It depends. Memorial Day, you'd fly it for the day. Okay, with the death of a president, maximum is 30 days, okay? So you'd have the president be 30 days. Reagan, they only flew it for 29 days because they wanted to have it at full staff for July the 4th. So they brought it up on the 29th day for Reagan. But depending on whether it be someone from the military or someone in state government or whatever, it would be determined, the White House would determine how long you would actually fly for at half staff. And then there are half days that you do fly it on half staff. Okay, coming up, you got December 7th. Okay, Pearl Harbor Day, you fly your flag at half staff on that day. 9/11, you fly your flag at half staff that day, Memorial Day. And there are other days throughout the year when you would do that. What else do I have? Question. The flag police will not come and arrest you, but it is good etiquette to illuminate it at night. We were just happy that people would fly the flag. I mean, it's like, wow, you know, you're flying a flag, it's really great, because it fell out of vogue many years ago, and then 9/11 kind of brought it back. It's kind of fallen out of vogue again. But the illumination at night, if you are going to illuminate it, I mean, there are a lot of ways you can do that. Just take a spotlight, and I like to put it close to the pole. I don't like to take it from the corner of your house and try and hit the flag, and all of a sudden you're shining your neighbor's window. Mm-hmm. Where you do it at the front, and then it would illuminate the front of the pole, and it would illuminate to the sky. The other thing is size of flag. And this would drive me crazy. We serviced a lot of flags in the area, and we installed a lot of flagpoles. There were an occasion where a building was built and the pole was installed by the builder. This would drive me crazy. Diamond Credit Union in Gilbertsville. The pole is so close to the building they cannot fly their flag at half staff because it bangs into the building. So I had to give them a small flag to fly at half staff. Citadel here in Eagle. They can't fly theirs at half staff because it's going to hit the corner of the overhang of the porch. The three flagpoles at the fire company in Downingtown, the poles are so close together that the flags are going to hit the pole next to it. What size do I fly? I like five, multiples of five. The width of the flag, five times that width is the height of the pole. So if you have a 25-foot pole, it would be a 5x8 flag, 5x5s are 25. If it's a 20-foot pole, it would be a 4x6 flag, 5x4 is 20. Now that's for a single flag. If you want to fly two flags, you would go to one size lower. So if it's a 25-foot pole, you would take that 5x8 flag and bring it down to a 4x6 and then fly a 3x5 under it. The flag under the U.S. flag can be anything other than that of another country. For whatever reason, the Irish and the Italians fly their flag under the U.S. flag, and that shows that's an insult to the Irish and to the Italians, because it shows domination, it shows dominance. So you should always have a flag other than that of another country under your flagpole. It can be a sports flag, a POW flag, a state flag, an anything flag, okay? What's anybody from the Navy? Okay. What is the one time that a flag can fly above the U.S. flag on the same flagpole? Navy chaplain flag on board ship when the chaplain's holding services. It's a dark blue flag with a white Christian cross. It's the only exception. So, looking at this, you know, we're looking at 522 years, and it's like, where are we now? I struggle with the fact that when you look through back of world history, the average lifespan of a country, a culture that was dominant in the world, it's about 200 years. You look at Greece, you look at Rome, you look at Spain, you look at England. Anybody from Scotland? Look at Scotland. Okay, the Scots are the most ferocious of fighters, the most loyal of people. They struggled breaking free from England because they fought amongst each other in clans. Had they united, they would have ruled the world. Look at the American Indians. You have folks that fought each other in tribes, and look at where they are now. And I say that now, you know, we signed the Constitution in 1787. 1987 is 200 years. We're in borrowed time, and we're fighting amongst ourselves. You want to go into denial and say we're always going to be America, but are we always going to be America? I mean, the Romans thought they were always going to be Rome. The Greeks thought they were always going to be Greece. And it's just the evolution of humanity as it goes through. So I'm looking. Yes, sir. How it became? Basically, it comes pretty much almost through war. It comes through conflict. It comes through confrontation, where you say, this is who we are. I mean, you look at the raising of the flag on Iwo Jima. I mean, that's a major thing, where it's now a symbol that says, we've succeeded. We're there. We've dominated. We've defeated the enemy. And it becomes the symbol. You look at all through the Civil War, all through the Revolution, any of those times, it was like when you see that, it gives you the hope that you're going to succeed in your mission and succeed in your effort. It represents the fabric of our being, in the point of, you know, the red being the blood that was shed, the white being the bandages, and the stars being the heavens, whatever. I mean, whatever this symbol, what you can imagine it to be in your own mind, it's one where it becomes a symbol of unification, a symbol of, I don't know if you want to say success, or of who we are. Do you have a thought of your own on that? If you look at the Romans, I mean, they had the Roman standard bearer. It was a large pole, and that flag had it hung vertically, and it had like a cable that would hold it. And the standard bearer was there, and when the standard bearer went down, somebody picked it up to continue carrying it. to say we're still advancing, we're still here, we still have a presence. And it was kind of a rally point, a focal point, to say we're still in the game. I mean, it goes back, like you're saying, it goes back pre-Roman times that would have that. So, yes. Betsy Ross. Did Betsy Ross make this flag? All the information we have on this came in a letter from Betsy Ross's grandson after she passed. So we'll never know. Do I think she did? I don't know. Well, Mary Pickersgill wasn't alive at the time that this was designed. So I don't know if she did or not. If you go to Valley Forge, you look at there's in front of the General Washington's headquarters. There's just a blue flag with stars. It's just a field of 13 stars on a blue flag, and that's it. So again, was that where he, you know, did he have influence there and then influence her? You know, did he design it? Who knows? So, yes, sir.
Is there any significance to the 5-point star versus the star?
Just that it was a 5-point for the one that has the circle of the Betsy Ross flag, and then it went to 7 for the Bennington, it went to 8. Because they didn't identify what it was.
These were all hand sewn back in the day, so they were made by somebody.
And then they had to come up with something, so they said, okay, the second flag act said one for every state as far as the stars, one for each of the first 13 colonies for the stripes. Actually, the White House is the one that will design. They will identify what the pattern is of the 50 stars or the 40 stars or whatever. When you look at the number of stars on a flag,
this is a 50-star flag. It became a 50-star flag. When do you add a star? You add a star on the 4th of July following admission to statehood. So this star was added on the 4th of July of 1960 with the admission of Hawaii. It became a 49-star flag on the 4th of July of 1959 with the admission of Alaska. It became a 48-star flag on the 4th of July of 1912 with Arizona and New Mexico. And then prior to that, it was 1908, was Oklahoma. So when people would come in the store and say, my house was built in such and such a year, what flag do I fly? Actually, this is a chart that shows the configuration of all the star patterns for the fields. And these are available. Now, they would not be embroidered. They would be a printed field of stars, and then you could have the sewn stripes with that. So all of these from Betsy Ross, you know, on, kind of changed within the time frame, but then all of a sudden, you know, when we get past the Second Flag Act, past the War of 1812, that's when it solidified itself to what we see today. Miss anything, John? It's not illegal to burn the flag. Congress said that that's a freedom of speech. I don't adhere to that. I don't think that we know many people that adhere to that. When they're retired, they are, well, we don't say they're burned. We say they're committed to the flame. And basically what will happen there is you will have a ceremony and you will then physically commit them to the flame and they will be destroyed in that manner. But to do it that way in, you know, a particular ceremony, and you have a lot of military, like at the Marine Corps League, we do 2,000-4,000 flags at a time on certain times throughout the year when we get, you know, a collection point and have, say, hey, we have to move all these out. We've had a number of Boy Scouts that did Eagle projects based on collection of flags, doing the ceremony, doing all of that, different things. But no, it's not illegal. You can take a knee in the NFL too, and that's not illegal either, but we don't watch the football games anymore. We do college instead of a professional. So. Anything else? Yes, sir. Chester Street in Downingtown. Yeah, Chester Street is the one where you can't get to it from Boot Road anymore because the bridge is closed, coming from the post office on Boot Road across Chester Street Bridge. But if you were to be on 30, Route 30, Business 30, and then turn onto Chester Street, it's the old Pepperidge Farm building. Victory Brewing is in that same complex. And there's a large red mailbox that has flag disposal on it. Okay, thank you.